The views and opinions of this broadcast do not reflect the views and opinions of Armed Media, UNU Productions and its affiliates. Enjoy the show.
Good evening and welcome to the Leadership with Biana Kovic show. Thank you for being with us tonight. Our topic, leadership, focuses on leaders such as yourselves. We believe that leadership is a skill that can be learned through practice and awareness. Our very special guest tonight is Stephenie Foster. Stephenie is a founding partner of Smash Strategies, which provides strategic advice to corporations, institutions, and philanthropists to ensure that their investments in women and girls are effective and transformational. From 2012 to 2017, she served at the U.S. Department of State, most recently as a senior advisor counselor in the Secretary's Office of Global Women's Issues, and before that, at a U.S. embassy in Kabul, where she focused on women and civil society. Prior to joining the State Department, she had her own consulting firm with an emphasis on domestic and international policy, advocacy, government affairs, and program development and training. Stephenie was chief of staff to United States Senators Barbara Mikulski and Chris Dodd, and in a senior management positions in the nonprofit sector. She is a frequent public speaker on women and foreign policy and has published extensively on women and politics. She started her career in a private law practice. Stephenie, good evening and welcome to the show.
Good evening and thank you for having me.
Stephenie, you are a partner at Smash Strategies that you co-founded in 2017. Can you tell us more about your company and the work that you do?
Of course. We really focus on how to capture the power of women and girls to make change. Mm-hmm. We believe, based on the research that has been done, that women contribute exponentially to society, and that right now companies, nonprofits, multilateral organizations aren't taking enough advantage of the talents and skills that women bring to the table. So the firm, which I co-founded with another appointee from the Obama administration, focuses on helping companies, institutions, and individuals focus on this space so that they can be as effective as possible in engaging women, whether it's as customers, as clients, as companies that are part of their supply chain, so that we can really unleash that potential across the globe.
I know that your company is also focusing on sustainable development goals, which is SDG 3 and SDG 5. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Sure. The SDGs were adopted several years ago at the UN by every country in the world, and including the United States. And what they do is set a series of goals and benchmarks for countries to look at in terms of their development, with the idea that in 15 years, countries should be reaching towards these goals, accomplishing their benchmarks, and really eradicating poverty and creating sustainable development. There are a number of sustainable development goals. One is particularly focused on women and girls, and that's SDG 5. All of the other goals focus on various parts of the development issues, health, education, climate, peace and security. And all of them have gender really woven into them. But there is one that's specifically focused on women and girls. What we see about the Sustainable Development Goals is that they're a really good framework for the work that governments and corporations, large institutions do, because they set standards, they put out benchmarks that were agreed to, again, by all of the countries in the world, and help people use those goals and benchmarks as a framework for the work they do. So we'll often talk to our clients about whatever the project is that they're focused upon, but also thinking about how they can use the Sustainable Development Goals to guide their work, to talk about their work, and to really put their work in that global context. One very important thing about the Sustainable Development Goals is that the United States is also part of them. These goals followed another set of development goals that were really only focused on developing countries. And so now we see that all the countries in the world are really using this framework to try to show how they have made progress on everything from developing legal frameworks that empower, in our case, women and girls, or how they look at programs that they're developing and the impact of those programs on women and girls. So it's a really good tool.
And how successful, in your opinion, are the countries in reaching SDG 3 and SDG 5?
Well, you know, it's really only been a couple of years. Mm-hmm. And I know that the UN just had a meeting last week or the week before focusing on how countries were doing. So I think that information is going to start coming out. I think we probably see more people focused on the Sustainable Development Goals as a framework in places that have historically used these types of goals. For example, their predecessor, the Millennium Development Goals, or MDGs. Mm-hmm. So I think we'll see. And, you know, it's hard to know, of course, because it's unclear in terms of consistency across countries, which agencies of the government, for example, will keep track of SDG progress. It's different probably in every country. And so it's really a matter of reporting into a centralized body, the UN, that keeps track of how countries are doing and then reports out. So I think we'll start finding out soon. As I said, they're pretty new in terms of implementation, and I don't think we can really tell yet.
Stephenie, you're a big advocate for women and girls' rights, and I was wondering if you could share your thoughts on the work that countries are doing to make women and girls' rights the norm.
Well, one thing that I think is very important to talk about in terms of engaging women and girls in society broadly is that the research shows us that there's a tremendous impact when women and girls are engaged. And I want to talk a little bit about that because it goes to your question. For example, a big study done by McKinsey, which is a global consulting firm, reflects that if women participated in the workforce at the same rate as men in every country, that global GDP would increase from anywhere between $12 trillion and $25 trillion in the next 10 years, which is a tremendous growth rate. $25 trillion, by the way, is the combined GDPs of the U.S. and China, the world's two largest economies. So what that study shows is that really engaging women in the economy, ensuring that they have the kind of livelihood training, vocational skills, and education they need can really unleash a lot of growth. We know that realistically we're not going to get to the $25 trillion, but it's really a good way to have a conversation and start conversations with people who might be less, you know, they're not uninterested, but they don't necessarily see engaging women and girls as an economic imperative, and it really is. And so I think what is changing is that for a long time, people spoke about engaging around these issues in a rights-based framework, which I think is good. But now we're really looking at the research and looking at the impact that women have in terms of unleashing economic growth. That's really critical, not just for the jobs that these women and their businesses create, but obviously jobs create stability. And it's in all of our best interest to have a world that's prosperous and secure. So we really see women as being integral to creating a more prosperous and secure future. I think that argument is an argument that moves a lot of people to being much more open to talking about what needs to be done to really ensure that women and girls have all the skills that they need and that legal barriers to their participation are taken down.
And would you say that public policy and politics are changing due to the SDG goals?
Well, I think it's really broader than the SDGs. I think that politics and policies are changing in response to the research and in response to the movement that has really started many years ago and continued to today to really engage women, to ensure that women have all the rights that men have, and to ensure that their skills and talents are unleashed. I mean, what we see is still, of course, there's a lot of work being done. But, for example, the World Bank does a report called Women, Business, and the Law, where countries report on the laws that they have in a number of categories that might disadvantage women. Everything from not having a paid leave policy, which is clear in the United States, or some countries have laws that make it harder for women to get loans. Some countries make it harder for women to actually work in certain professions. So what this report does is document those legal barriers, and there are a tremendous number of them. But then it also provides a roadmap in countries for governments and activists who want to take action to really look at what can be done in their countries in a very concrete way to address these barriers. And so we see, I think, people using these various documents and roadmaps that have been compiled through the World Bank, through other independent consulting agencies, through the Women's World Economic Forum in Davos, using these reports as a roadmap to what needs to be done to level the playing field so that women and men, boys and girls, are treated fairly and equally.
In our conversation prior to this interview, we talked about your company and its approach, which is very holistic when it comes to working with organizations and corporations. You mentioned that you provide support when it comes to strategic advice, advocacy, measuring impact, collaboration and networking, gender investing, and philanthropic branding. Could you tell us the importance of each?
I think one thing that to start with is that we know broadly that all of the issues that affect women and men, frankly, are interrelated. We know that often we talk about issues in different silos, as we say. We talk about education or the environment or job creation. But in reality, these sectors are very interrelated. And it's important to take an approach that really looks at how each of the parts of what we want to do interact with each other. So that's the framework that we use broadly, is to be holistic, to look for connections that people might not look for on their own. And indeed, with our firm, we find that in providing strategic advice to clients, again, whether that's a company, a corporation, a multilateral institution like the World Bank or some kind of nonprofit institution, we really want to look at who's out there in the field already doing work. What can we learn about what they're doing so that companies can either learn lessons from that or they can reach out to that entity and think about how to work with them? One of the issues that a lot of people talk about is the need to not duplicate efforts that are already going on and to learn from what has been done in the past so that we're not continually reinventing the wheel, as we say. So part of providing strategic advice is really looking at the landscape of whatever the topic is or the issue is that our clients want to work on, figuring out who's out there, who's doing work, who's doing good work, what lessons can be learned from both successes and failures in the field. One of the most important things that we find is to really measure impact, because it's very easy to identify a problem and think about a solution, but more important to see if that solution works. And so really looking at how to create evaluations and reporting mechanisms that look at not only the things that are easy to measure, the number of people who go to a training, the number of people who buy a product, the number of people who decide to run for office, but for example, what impact they have when they get there. So that's a very big part of what we do, is helping clients think about measuring impact in both quantitative ways, so obviously the ways that we measure numbers of things that happen, but also the stories that come out of it. Because as we know, as people, people listen to stories and learn a lot and become engaged when they hear from somebody who's actually already seen the impact of something on their lives and taken advantage of some kind of, whether it's a product or a service or a training, something like that. So those are really important things we do in terms of helping our clients think about measuring impact.
So how do you ensure that that impact is sustainable?
Sure. I mean, I think there are two or three different answers in a way. It's sustainable for a business if their business grows and if they're able to reach a new market and make money from the way that they've interacted with that market niche. So with companies that are doing this for profit, it's a little bit easier because obviously it's all embedded in a business model. We find in other situations where it's about really investing in development, whether it's by the government or companies that do investment and development through their corporate social responsibility, is how to look at that impact in a way that is sustainable. The first thing I would say about that is that it's really important when people are creating programs that are looking to solve a development problem, a social issue, to really talk to the people who will be part of that initiative. There's a saying in development, which is nothing about them without them, which means you shouldn't be developing programs without talking to people, basically, and understanding the cultural context in which people live and work and things that may or may not work for them. So that's really important. On an aside, I would say we often don't think about the things that we do every day that do have some kind of context, or we have sort of an overlay of them that seems obvious to us but maybe not to others. For example, when a meeting is held can have an impact on who goes. Women often can't go to meetings in the evening. There might be, depending on the cultural context, a better time for women because of the way their schedules work, because women around the world bear the burden of caregiving as well as oftentimes working. So looking at things like what will help them, what do they need? So that's a really important thing in terms of sustainability. Secondly, is to develop an approach that really brings people in and gives them interest and say in how the project or program will be designed so that then it does sustain itself over time, even after outside funds have left the project or aren't available. It's very important to create buy-in from people and to really focus on looking at impact in the short, medium, and long term so that you can see what impact you've had in the short term, but really put it in the broader context.
And what I'm also hearing is meaningfully engaging them in the conversation.
Absolutely.
I have mentioned before that your company does a philanthropic branding. Can you talk to us about it?
Sure. I mean, again, I think looking at philanthropies, whether it's an individual or a fund, really important for all of those entities to think about branding their work, just like companies think about branding their work, so that people understand essentially what they're giving to and what their funds will be used for. So that's one of the important things in that realm is, again, really helping entities think about what they're doing in a way that helps them tell their story by branding their work, whether it's through the name of the entity, but really much more so about how they tell their story, how they talk about their impact, and how they think about bringing other people into their work through engaging them, not just by asking for money, and not just by having events, but by putting the work they do in a broader context. And I'm going to give you an example. So I've done a lot of work in Afghanistan, and there's a lot of giving around trying to help various causes and groups in Afghanistan. One of the most important things to me is whatever is being done to help women or refugees or children or any group in Afghanistan, is really to place that work in a branding sense as part of how it will contribute to building a stronger future for Afghanistan and creating a more secure Afghanistan. So it's about doing your work, but also talking about it in a way that puts it in a bigger picture so that people understand why you're doing it and why their contribution or engagement with you matters in a big picture way.
Can you talk to us about the importance of networking and collaboration, and especially when you are on the grounds of another country?
Well, I think that's one of the most important things to do, because none of the organizations or companies, multilateral organizations, nonprofits, can do anything really on their own. We all need to work together to really meet a common goal. When I was in the government, it was often the case that there would be programs in a country, and then we didn't spend as much time as we should have really looking at sometimes who else was in that country doing similar work, so that we were able to essentially divide up the work, right? So that you have everyone going towards a common goal, but not, for example, if you're working on an issue like health, having two or three groups working in one province and no groups working in another. So really, clearly, through my work with the government, seeing the critical nature of collaboration on the ground in terms of providing services and programs. But I think the other way to think about collaboration and networking is that we do this work, but we overlay it with advocacy and the importance of talking about the work, trying to change policies, trying to ensure that people are engaged in the issue, that there's funding for the work, whether that's lobbying Congress or other institutions. And so you really can't run an effective advocacy campaign if you're not collaborating with other people, understanding how people might engage with your issue from diverse backgrounds, from backgrounds that you wouldn't necessarily think of in your day-to-day work. And that's a very important place that we need to collaborate. But also when you do advocacy, it's important to also talk about the collaboration you do on the ground, because just as important as doing the work is ensuring, again, that there's broad community buy-in. And broad community buy-in really happens when you're collaborating with lots of groups who feel part of what you're doing. And you're bringing lots of people in to your project, to your work, to the way that you are trying to address and solve a problem.
This leads me to my next question, which is how to ensure that people that are supposed to receive the services are actually receiving them, and at the same time, how to ensure that people will continue to meaningfully use the services, especially once the organization leaves the grounds.
Well, I think a lot of it goes back to ensuring that as initiatives are developed, that people who are on the ground, who will be participating in the programs, who will benefit from them, are part of planning, essentially, for those initiatives. If you think about what we do in business, when companies go out, they talk to people about their products before they sell them. They want to make sure they're meeting a market niche. And so I don't believe that development work is the exact same thing as business, but I do think it's very important as you're developing a program to ensure that people who are going to be part of it are part of it, and that they're part of it from the beginning. So I think there's so many programs around the world, and very hard to generalize about what can be done in every context to ensure that the people who are on the ground who need services get them. But I think ensuring that people participate in the planning and actually in an ongoing conversation about how a project is going gets you to a better place. Another way to think about this is that it's important to ensure that there's a broad group of people who understand what this SAY project is actually doing, and I'm going to give you an example. We often find around the world that people go in and there'll be some kind of economic development project or project around civic engagement targeted at women to really increase women's empowerment and engagement, which is great. However, sometimes if men don't understand what's going on in the community, or maybe only certain groups of women have gone to the meeting, or whatever, it creates a question about what's really going on that can make it harder for the program to be successful. Or in some cases can actually create tension in families and communities that can be very difficult. So bringing in groups of people in the community, or bringing in the entire community, so that they understand what the project is about, what its goals are, how it will benefit people, really makes a difference. And I think goes to your issue of how to create sustainability, how to create community buy-in, so that when outside money is no longer there or there's less of it, the community has a sense that this is theirs, that they've seen a benefit, and that they want to continue with it. And hopefully these programs have created viable businesses so that women can continue their businesses, they can continue to sell products, and they are launched off into the economic environment in their country and are able to participate and create jobs.
What are your thoughts on women taking an active role when it comes to job creation?
I know from my work, both in the government and outside, that there are a tremendous number of women around the world who are engaged in their communities, starting businesses, whether they're agribusinesses, textile businesses, service-related businesses, where they're really tapping into a market niche and are growing, growing businesses, creating jobs. Just last week, I worked with a group of African women entrepreneurs who were here in the United States as part of a State Department exchange program. And this program has been around for about 8 years. About 20 women come every year from countries across sub-Saharan Africa for something that's called a visitor leadership program, where they come to the United States, they interact with experts in business, both in the Washington, D.C. area, but across the country, and they learn about new markets, about what they need to do to access markets in the U.S. and outside their countries, what kind of standards their products need to meet, all the things that a business needs to really worry about. I can tell you that these women are very sophisticated. They really know their products. They really are thinking strategically about how to grow their market share, what they need to do to brand their products, what they need to do to break into new markets. There are a lot of women around the world doing just that right now. And the more that we can do to support them, whether it's in terms of, in the case of the U.S., the State Department and USAID support these women abroad in terms of training and ensuring that they are able to meet experts who can help them broaden their business and create stronger business plans. The corporate sector is doing that because often these women will be part of the corporate supply chain. And then as individuals, really seeking out women-owned businesses and products from those businesses around the world as we shop, whether it's here or as we travel, all of those things can help these women really expand their ability to create jobs and to create growth in their home countries.
You mentioned that you did work in Kabul, and in 2013 you have received the Department of State Superior Honor Award for your work in Afghanistan. Can you tell us a little bit more about that work?
Well, sure. I was in Afghanistan at the U.S. Embassy for a little bit over a year. I was responsible for a broad portfolio around women in civil society, which meant that I interacted on a daily basis with groups that represented women business owners, women in health, women in education, women who were creating businesses across Afghanistan, women who were going to the university, just broad swaths of the Afghan population who were doing interesting things and were really doing work to create opportunity for Afghan women and Afghan men. I also oversaw a grant program that helped with small businesses, the kind of businesses we were just talking about in terms of the African Women Entrepreneurs Program, that would also help Afghan women business owners jumpstart their businesses and create stronger products so they would be able to expand their market. It was a great opportunity and experience for me. I was able to travel all over the country. I met a tremendous number of people, really saw the vibrancy and resilience of Afghans. Given the situation in terms of conflict and war, I was so impressed with their interest and ability to look to rebuilding their country in a way that created opportunity for people and created a stronger future. I've since was back to Afghanistan once when I was at the State Department and will likely be going again in the next couple of weeks, focusing on some election-related issues as they have an election coming up in the fall.
Any success stories that you can share with us?
Sure. I have two success stories that I'll share. However, I do want to say there are really thousands of them in terms of women really making a difference, building a better future. One of the women that I met is now in the government. She is very high up in the Ghani administration. But when I met her, she was something, you know, we would call a serial entrepreneur, right? She had four businesses. She had been a dressmaker during the Taliban and actually ran a tailoring and dressmaking business underground because, of course, women weren't allowed to work during the Taliban officially. So she was a dressmaker during that period. After the Taliban fell, she continued that work. So she had a fashion-related business, but she also had a business exported dry fruits and nuts to countries around the world, Dubai, Russia, the U.K., just a really, really successful business. She also did some consulting on how to develop strong businesses and some consulting for USAID. She was someone who was really a multifaceted entrepreneur. She was successful in virtually every one of her businesses and was able to really see opportunity at every turn. And despite the difficulties, she really prospered. She since has gone into the government. She was first working directly for the president of Afghanistan, but is now in the ministry. And so I think not doing as many of her businesses, but she's amazing. And I think it's a story that really shows the impact that one person can have looking across a series of businesses. The second woman I want to talk about started a company in Afghanistan, a software development company in the western part of the country, which is near Iran. She saw that there was a need for jobs that women could do, not necessarily leaving their homes. And she also was had been interested and had studied computer science on her own. She started this business, has employed a tremendous number of women doing coding at home, mostly. She has been profiled numerous times in a lot of international magazines and is the coach of the Afghan Girls Robotics Team, which is an exciting group of young women who have come to compete in a robotics competition to really show that Afghan women and girls have the skills and talents that are necessary to be part of the robotics revolution.
So women that you talked about, they are leaders and entrepreneurs. And I was wondering, are there any traits that leader needs to have to be truly successful?
I think leaders need a couple of really important traits. I think leaders need to have a vision. They need to know where they're going, number one. Number two, they have to be able to communicate that vision to other people and get people excited about doing what needs to be done to get to that vision. Because along the way, some of those tasks aren't always glamorous. And thirdly, I think leaders have to really be good listeners. Because often we think that it's all about telling people what to do and speaking to them and really encouraging people through what we say. But I think as leaders, listening is critically important so that we understand what people's perspectives are, what their reactions are, how they see themselves fitting into whatever the project or work is that we are trying to accomplish as leaders. I also would say that being able to give good feedback is critically important to being a good leader. And that feedback has to be honest and help people grow. I do know, personally, it's very difficult sometimes to give feedback if you feel like you're saying to somebody you're not doing as well as I think you could or you need to improve. But leaders need to be able to do that so that people understand that leaders care about that individual's career development. The overall vision, good communication skills, good listening skills, and being able to really engage with the people who are either working for you or a part of a group that you are organizing for advocacy or for whatever your goal is.
So talking about giving feedback to people, what are your thoughts on folks that are not amicable to receiving a feedback?
Feedback is critically important. I know I've gotten feedback about my job performance numerous times over my career. I have not always liked what people said to me because I have always felt I did a really great job. But I have since learned that there's always room to do a better job and that realistically there are some things people do better than others. I'm strong in certain things, not as strong in others. And I once had a supervisor tell me something that at first I was kind of angry about, but then realized he was right, really took that into account and worked on the issue that that supervisor had identified and got better at it. Feedback can really help you identify places where you need to improve. The good news is, oftentimes those are things that you can actually work on and practice and get better. So placing feedback in the context of helping people become better at their job is exceptionally important. If someone doesn't want to listen to feedback, at a certain point, it's very difficult. I don't know exactly what to do. I think you have to keep working on that person until they understand you're not trying to undercut them. You're not trying to belittle them. You're really genuinely trying to ensure that they do the best job possible, not just for you in the job you're working together on, but in their future. It's really about thinking about how to expand their career options and ensure that they have the most ability to be successful as they learn and grow over their career.
What are the ways that you evaluate your own success?
Well, before I answer that, I do want to say one other thing about developing skills, and it goes to success a bit. When I was a young girl, I was very shy and wasn't someone who liked to speak publicly. At a certain point, I realized I really wanted to be a lawyer. I had a good skill set in terms of analysis and was able to weave a lot of things together to make a really good argument on paper. But being a good lawyer is also about being able to get up and talk about your client, your advocacy goal, the law, your case. And I had to decide if I really wanted to become a good public speaker so that I could be a good lawyer. And I did. I practiced all the time. I wasn't always good, but I decided if this was what I wanted to do, it was a skill that I thought I could develop through practice. And I did over many years. And I use that as an example often when I speak to groups, and I am often a public speaker, to say there are things that you may be nervous about trying to develop in your career skills, but most things you can actually get better at through practice, through being very mindful, and through talking to other people who you see as being good at those skills and finding out what they did to get there. Those are really important lessons that I learned as a young lawyer, as a young professional, and they're really important for all of us because we all have things that we are nervous about taking on, but most of those things through practice can really be addressed.
So what you're saying to us is be open to receive feedback and then use that feedback in your practice so that you can get better at what you do.
I think so.
So you worked with many organizations, and I was wondering, how did you ensure that teams that you worked with were all always moving towards the same goal?
Sure. I think in any organization, just like when we're talking about leadership, it's really important to have a vision, to ensure that people know where they fit in that vision, how they contribute to it, and how they're going to be evaluated on what they do. So whether it's writing a brief because you have a team of lawyers, or you're putting together an advocacy plan, or you're putting together a business plan, or you're trying to make sure that an event happens. Every person who's part of those teams needs to understand what the ultimate goal is, how they fit into it, and how they'll be evaluated for progress. To me, those are the ways that teams are the most successful. Leaders also, to me, on teams, need to be able to ensure that they feel comfortable when there is conflict on a team, because there often is. And when I say conflict, I don't mean people yelling at each other, but at times people can work at cross purposes if they're not really thinking through what the goals are, they're not really focused on what needs to be done, or sometimes people can be not getting along. Leaders need to be able to have effective ways to deal with conflict, to ensure that people feel that their views are heard, that the conflict is resolved, and that the team can move forward. Without that, oftentimes the conflict can really become a bigger problem, and especially if you have a project that has a lot of time constraints, can create a lot of issues.
Some leaders think that positive conflict among teams are healthy. Even having some level of competition is very healthy for the team and for the initiative that team is working towards. What are your thoughts on that?
I would distinguish between conflict and actually a competition of ideas. Mm-hmm. I do agree that everyone on the team should have the ability to question the vision, to question the goals, talk about what the best way is to get there, to put their views on the table so that people have the benefit of everyone's best thoughts. But once I think a decision is made about where to go, what the vision is, what the goals are, I don't think that conflict really helps move things along. So I see conflict as different than a competition of ideas, of everyone having the ability to put their thoughts out, to question, to ask about a lot of assumptions, to ensure that really the project is going to the right place. As a leader, that I think is very critically important, because I don't want people on my team to not question things or not say, have you thought about something, or are you sure this is going to work, or I saw that in another similar project this didn't work. That's very healthy, but that's different than conflict.
So asking for clarification, in your opinion, is very healthy.
Asking for clarification, saying what you think, it's your responsibility as a team member to raise an issue if you feel that that issue is relevant to how the project, you know, goes, whether it's going to be successful or not. When I am a staff person, I think my job is to give my boss the best advice possible based on my experience. And frankly, if I don't do that, say I don't say something in the meeting or to my boss and the project fails, and it fails because of something I failed to raise, that's a really bad thing. So it doesn't mean because I raised something that that is necessarily what's going to happen, or we may decide to go forward with a project in a way that I don't agree with, but it is your responsibility as a member of the team to say your best advice. But it's also, I think, your responsibility to then implement the vision of your, you know, of your leadership of the team going forward. If you can't do that, then, you know, you probably have to think about whether that's the right place for you to work. But I think it's inherent in all of our professional capacities to give the best advice we can, because after all, that's why we're there. We get hired because we have experience, and we get hired because that experience gives us the ability to have thoughts and to have critical analysis and to be able to move forward.
That's a very well put it. So what you're saying, equal contribution is a must for a team to be successful.
Yes.
So any thoughts on low-performing teams or failed initiatives?
Again, I think broadly in terms of performance, very important to make sure that teams understand what the goals are and how they fit into the goals. There may be teams of people that truly are all low performers, but often it's my experience that teams don't understand what the goal is, or they don't feel valued, or individuals don't feel valued. And when someone doesn't feel valued, sometimes they don't work as hard as someone who does feel valued. Because if you feel part of the team, you feel your experience and your views are being taken into account, then I think that helps people want to do the best they can. So I would say, of course, sometimes there are low-performing team members, and I think, unfortunately, sometimes if you can't help that person do a better job, then you probably have to help them figure out where else they're going to work. But I think oftentimes people don't have enough guidance about the goal and enough guidance about how they fit into the team and how it's going to meet, you know, its ultimate goal.
And in which way do you think media affects leadership style in your industry?
I think media affects leadership probably across industry, because I think media has an overwhelming impact on the way we see and think of leaders. We see movies about leaders and TV shows about leaders. We see lots of different kind of caricatures of leaders. So I think media is something that has an impact on the way we think about leadership generally. To me, leadership is about the things that we talked about, having a vision, being a good communicator, being a good listener. I think the one part about the media and leadership that is something that I am mindful of is that as a woman, sometimes the media is not kind to women leaders. There can be a lot of talk about, you know, is a woman, she's either too aggressive or not aggressive enough. Things that would not be said about a man in a similar situation can be said about a woman. So I think media has an impact on how women are portrayed in leadership across industries. You can look at politics, you can look at the business sector, you can look at a lot of things, and you'll see that if a woman doesn't have kids, it's a negative. If she has kids, why isn't she at home with them? It can be kind of crazy. So I think because that's out there, there are two things to say. People need to think about how to do their jobs in a way that creates strong teams, and also speak out about different leadership styles. One of the most important things is to show that there's not just one leadership style. There's not just one style of being a CEO or a COO or a CFO or the head of a government agency. There are many, many different ways to do things. The Prime Minister of New Zealand, for example, just had a baby. That's a different model. Tammy Duckworth just had a baby. She's a U.S. senator from Illinois. That's a different model. The more that we show that there are different ways to be leaders, I think it helps address this media dynamic that sometimes can have an impact on how women view their potential as leaders.
So reflecting on your own leadership style, what would you say your leadership style is like?
I hope that I am able to say that I have a vision, that I listen to people, and that I communicate well what I'm looking for the end goal to be. I do think it's important to listen to everybody's views, but I also think it's important to understand that once decisions are made, we have to implement them and ensure that we meet the goal. So my leadership style is inclusive, but yet I think very focused.
So you worked with many people from many different countries. Have you changed your leadership style according to the country that you worked with? Or
that's a good question. When I'm in a country that's not my own, paying specific intentional interest in what people are saying and understanding how people communicate there, what works there, that might be different than in the United States. For example, in a lot of countries I've worked, there's a premium on, you know, really getting to know the person before you do business or before you really engage in a project. You know, you have coffee with them or tea with them or a meal with them. It's a little less transactional than we can be in the United States, frankly. We get there, we do our business, we're done. And I think it's important to be mindful of the fact that doing that in another country can actually send a very bad signal and be disrespectful. So learning about what works in a country before you go, before you work there, is critically important. It doesn't change my view of the importance of vision and communication and listening and evaluating. It means, though, that understanding the context in which we work is critically important, because just as we live in a particular cultural context, so does everyone else. It's even true across the United States. People have different ways of doing things. Important to think about that when you work in another country, to really ensure that what you're doing is not somehow disrespectful or offensive to people, so that they understand that they're important to you. And that's the most important thing about those signals. Saying to people through the signals of eating with them or making sure you're not doing something else that they don't do in their culture that says, I respect you and I think you're important and I want to listen to you.
So what you're saying, be culturally sensitive.
Yes.
Some leaders think that generosity and leadership are closely connected. What are your thoughts on that?
If you mean generosity of spirit, really including people, mm-hmm. Yes, I think that's true. I do think important to think about the context, to be a generous leader in every context, but in certain tactical moments, you just have to get the job done. So it's not very generous. You're just telling someone if it's an emergency situation or you're at something where you have to move fast and a lot of sort of extra verbiage is not helpful, then I think people expect that. If you're in a job that's very pressured and you're dealing with emergencies all the time. But you can step back and outside of the particular context of your job, the moment in which you have to provide a service very quickly or respond to something, I think listening is a very generous part of leadership because you are trying to bring people into what you're doing.
This leads me to my next question, which is how do you stay humble while you lead others?
For me, I think that leaders stay humble when they recognize that everybody has something to contribute to the workplace, to developing solutions, and to moving forward. We all need to understand that people have a wide range of skills that they bring to the workplace and enthusiasm, and that we can all learn from each other. The best leaders that I have been able to work with are people who reflect just that quality of understanding that they don't have all the answers and that other people have answers and that together we can patch together all those pieces and come up with something that works to really catapult us to the next level. So I think humility is really important to an effective workplace. And to get there, it's really about listening and understanding that everyone has a role to play.
Any thoughts on how we can encourage women to take on leadership roles and stay in leadership positions?
Well, I think there are a few things we can do, and they are things that companies can do and organizations and things that we in our educational institutions can do as well. In terms of starting early, we need to encourage girls and then young women to really participate as leaders in whatever organization they're working in, whether it's something at their school, the Girl Scouts, something that they're doing where they can really explore their skills, their confidence, and really build upon all of that so that as they're making decisions about what they want to do with their careers and their lives, that they feel confident in their ability to do that. And then once we get to high school and college, really, again, asking educational institutions to not make assumptions about the kind of topics and subjects that young women want to study. So encouraging women in both traditional and non-traditional fields, the professions, science and technology, ensuring that all of those fields are open to women and that professors and counselors are really encouraging young men and young women to enter the professions that are most suitable to the skills that they have. Once young women get out into the workforce, again, I think that whether it's a company the person works for, a nonprofit, a large government or state government, really, again, looking at how to use all the skills that that young woman has and encourage her to develop more skills and to take on increasing tasks with increasing responsibility, just as is often done with young men. The reason I think this is so important is that we often make assumptions that young men are leaders and young women aren't, and that isn't true. We need to really encourage leaders, whoever they are, whatever they look like, whatever, you know, package they come in. And that is by providing the maximum number of opportunities to develop leadership skills for those companies. It ties back, of course, to companies being more effective and able to make a bigger profit as they have more diverse leadership. And research shows that more diverse groups lead to more innovative solutions. And we really need that in the modern and complex world in which we live. The last thing I'll say is not only getting women into those jobs, but keeping them there is important. And that's not just everything we've talked about, but also having really strong anti-discrimination policies, enforcing them, having strong coaching situations where older, more experienced employees are helping younger employees, again, develop their skills, and ensuring there are strong anti-harassment policies. We've talked a lot in this last year about the Me Too movement, but the reality is that a lot of that still goes on in terms of sexual harassment at the workplace. And so companies need to have strong policies to deter that kind of behavior, and also strong policies so that both women and men can take time to have families and balance the work that they do and usually really want to continue to work in with raising a family. So I think there's a broad range of things we can do, all again with two goals. One is maximizing the talent that we have and really understanding that when we have diverse groups of people solving problems, the research shows that those solutions tend to be more effective, they tend to be more reflective of what works for the most people, and they tend to help companies be the most competitive they can be in the marketplace.
Any final thoughts?
I would say, first of all, I really want to thank you for having me on the show. Mm-hmm. I really want to thank the audience for listening and for being part of this conversation over time that you're having about leadership, because these are issues that are so important in today's world. My final thought overall is that leadership is about valuing everyone equally and their contribution, whether it's a person is a man or a woman, whatever their age is, their ethnic group, their religion, really looking at people and the contributions that they have to make to solving a problem as really important, as people who are part of the solution and who help us get to where we need to go and create a better future.
And how can people get in contact with you?
I am on two websites. Mm-hmm. One is smashstrategies.com, or I have a personal website as well, stephaniefoster.com. And there are easy ways to get in touch with me through both of those websites. And I welcome anyone getting in touch and starting the conversation.
Stephenie, it was wonderful having you on the show. Thank you very much for being our guest.
Thank you.
And with that, thank you all for tuning in and listening to the Leadership with Biana Kovic show. Please remember that you are leaders in your own rights, and the impact that you're meant to achieve starts with small acts of care, kindness, and generosity. Wishing you a wonderful evening. Please come back next Monday, August 20th, 9 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. Thank you again, and have a great night.